tell me what it means, what you feel about Black Broadway as a show.
Oh, Black Broadway, to be in a show called Black Broadway is something else. That's like being in a show called Ziegfeld Follies, which was very happy days of my life. I shall never forget that. And I don't know how I'll ever forget Black Broadway either. It was a good show, the people are so nice. And when I see dancers dance, you know, as of today, since I can't dance, it just makes me think about what they are missing that they can't find, which is very interesting to me. Because the dancers today don't have the creation for steps as I had in the days gone by. Because I guess they got their minds on too many things in the future. I wouldn't know how it happened, but that's the way it goes.
So what do you feel inside when you see people dancing and you know that you could get up there and be the boss and you're...
I just feel good to know somebody's got the idea to do it in the way that Gregory Hines does his. Which is very interesting. He reminds me of the Berry Brothers when they're coming along in the years gone by, how the Berry Brothers used to create in their turns and steps and struts. I used to like them and watch them very much. And then I had Tom Patricola, that was had Jack Donahue, then we had Fred Astaire, and Eleanor Powell, and all the dancers I've come in contact with, which was very interesting. And when I see these boys today, I get on down to where Red Cookie dances and Bubba Gaines. That's it. When I get out of Bubba Gaines, I say he with his rope dance. That's something I never could do. I could jump rope, but I couldn't dance jumping rope. But I could dance and write my name, which nobody else have ever done yet. I used to write my name and write Merry Christmas and Happy New Year dancing. You know, that was a feat to me then. I used to wait when the snow was on the ground. I used to dance in the snow, so it just falls on the ground, and write in the snow. But that time, I didn't have the idea of chalk on your shoe. Then I put chalk on my shoe and started writing it with chalk, you know, which was a good, good send-off. I'll never forget that.
Bubbles, you know, many people say that there were the two great dancers were you and Bill Robbins.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people say you were the greatest. What do you say about
it? I can't say but one thing. If they practice as much as me, they must be the greatest. If they practice as much as me, because I used to dance all night long, you know. And I have to take off my shoes to keep from waking the people up downstairs, which was a treat to me again. I dance at 6 o'clock in the morning, go down to the corner, get myself a cup of coffee and a donut, and cry like a baby. Because I'm so happy for learning the step that I stayed up all night to get. Then I come back on 7th Avenue and show the step, man, nobody could do it. And I feel great to know that these dancers come along and they think they're going to be great dancers, but they don't put no time in to learn or teach themselves, you know. There's so very few people that know how to improvise on steps and create. When I was about so high, my mother said I used to cry for her to put taps on my shoes. And every time she'd ask me why, I would tell her this was my reply. I want to dance wherever there's people who are happy and laughing, so I'd like to see them smile. And they can hear the sound of my feet, that would make them smile more. You know, I say, you don't need no taps to go to Harlem, you don't need no taps to go to Spain. And I do a song like that and do the Lowdown, another one, Spanish Town, which are very good songs, very good dances to go with it, you know. I was just going to open up a school called AFFIT, American Federation for Improving Talent, when I got this stroke. I got everything all set up for it and everything, and I got the stroke, I couldn't go no further. But I still got the place. But dancing and this show is something else. Black Broadway, I'm so glad you thought of it, I don't know what to do. It gives me a new lease on life.
You give a lot of people a new lease on life, I'd say, just being there.
Who influenced him when he started?
What'd you say?
Who influenced you when you first started dancing? Who helped you create your own style?
My desire helped create it. Because I was working at the Audubon Theater at 168th Street and Broadway at the time my throat cracked, my voice cracked rather, and I couldn't hit the high note that I generally hit. I hit it and slid off of it. Then I said, I got to do something else besides sing. So I picked up dancing when I was 18 years old. And I started dancing then. I didn't stop until I got to the place where I said, I'm going to be the greatest dancer in the world. And I didn't let up.
Well, who were the dancers that were dancing when you were 18 years old?
Bill Robson was dancing, so was Eddie Rector, and that was Snake Hip Stucker, that was the Lucky Seven Trio, and there's Tip Tap and Toe, the Berry Brothers, and Maxine McCree, and Tom Patricola, and Eleanor Powell, and I was about, I guess, 16 or 17, no, 18 years old, when Eleanor Powell's mother brought her backstage at the in Providence, for me to teach her a few steps. And she was a little girl. Mm-hmm.
How did George Gershwin happen to write the part Porgy and Bess? How did he happen to have you in mind? So say, when George Gershwin asked me,
When George Gershwin decided he would like me to go in his show, he came and asked my manager at the time, and my manager told him, sure, what do you want to do? He wanted to take me without my partner, but I wouldn't go. He had to take Buck also. Because if the show wasn't a success, you see, I wouldn't have nothing to work with. And Buck and I had been together for over 35 years at that time. So he put Buck in doing Mingo, and he put me in the show, and he took me to his apartment to teach me the song in his apartment himself, so I'd be sure I'd get it. And he was quite pleased. I never forget, he was so pleased the man wanted to throw me out because I couldn't get in on the right note in the beginning of the rehearsal. And he said, throw him out, throw him out. Gershwin come down there, I said, throw him out. We can't throw him out, he's a black Toscanini. I said, hmm? And when Gershwin went back to the back of the theater, Mr. Alexander Small picked up the baton to lead the orchestra, I stepped on my foot over the footlights and said, Mr. Smallins, if I had the way that you conduct, I'd be a millionaire. So from then on, they thought about me being able to do the show. I did everybody's part, which was interesting. I used to do Jake, and I used to do the crawfish man, and the strawberry woman, Helen Dowdy. I used to, strawberries, they go fresh and fine, they just often divine, strawberries. And I used to do Porgy's part too. Oh, Bess, it's hot in here. Let me set out with you in the cool. Porgy, I got plenty of love for you now. Oh, Bess. I did the show just like that. And I used to sing a part in the boat that's leaving. That Alexander Smalley used to say to me, say, why do you sing that? I said, I can't help myself. He's right on that. There's a boat that's leaving soon for New York. Come with me. I used to hum that every time. And he used to ask me why I did it. I said, I couldn't help myself. And when I was learning, I just learned by the steps, you know. I learned my melody from the steps I could put in the music, which was quite interesting.
Did you dance in that show?
No. Just a second. I just want to wipe them off because they don't look so good.
Ethel Waters. Tell us a little bit about Ethel Waters.
I want to say that she's a good entertainer, a good singer, and a good Samaritan.
Start over and say Ethel Waters was.
Ethel Waters was a good singer, as you know. And she was a good Samaritan and a good person to work with. I played with her many times. Sorry I had to kill her in the picture, but that's the way it went, you know. I had to kill Rochester too, you know. He took my girl from it, which was Lena Horn, and my partner was a Western Union boy. He brought the telegram where Rochester had hit the sweepstakes, and he took the money and took Lena Horn out for a big time. So Ethel Waters was looking for Rochester, because Rochester was her husband. And while she was looking for Rochester, we found that he was with Lena Horn. So when he was with Lena Horn, I said, I tried to wash him away. But I still tried to make Ethel Waters fall in love with me before she got back to him. But she couldn't pay me no attention.
Did you know Florence Mills?
Oh, no. Didn't get a chance to know her. She just left us when we came to New York. She just passed away.
Was there much jealousy between you and Bill Robinson?
No, I wasn't playing where he was playing. There was no jealousy to be because of the fact that I could sing and dance, and he couldn't sing, but he could dance. That's why there was no jealousy. And I would never do his steps. I don't want to do my own steps, you know? But I was at the McVickers Theater in Chicago one day, and they had a stool, one of the highest bar stools down in the pit, and I danced on the stool, got her on stage, come back down. He started looking for me with a gun. And my partner coming to me and said, Bill Robbins looking for you. I said, what for? About that staircase you did on the chair? I said, is he really? Well, let him find me because I'm right over here. But I went to find him and he wasn't looking for me really at all. It was just his idea of bluffing, you know? He's a good guy. He didn't mean no harm. Just didn't know what he should do. Poor fellow. I can always marvel at Fanny Robinson, how well she had trained him to do what he does, to try to help him save his money, stop him from gambling. He didn't drink nothing, but she would always look after him. And that's why, I guess, why they separated, because he would do the things he should do where she was concerned, because she was a lovely woman. Wasn't for her, he wouldn't be nowhere. God rest his soul.
When did you meet UB Blake?
I met him in Blackbirds.
I met UB
Blake in Blackbirds when I did a song there with Nika Shaw at the same time Ethel Waters and Bill Bailey was in the show and the Bear Brothers. And I did the show, the song called Lucky to Me. I guess you heard that. Whenever you're near, all my fears disappear, dear. It's plain as can be, you're lucky to me. My only luck charms are your two loving arms. Anybody can see, you're lucky to me. No harm can happen to me anymore. I'm writing 13s all over my door. My mother and dad thought that our luck was bad, but like we, they agree, you're lucky to me. That was a pretty song. Then we did a Soft Shoe Dance, and Ethel Waters, she would do a reprise of the song after we got through with it, you know, which was lovely, lovely. Don't forget that show either. What knocked me out, though, when we played the Ziegfeld Follies, there was no act could follow our act because we come on about 20 minutes to 12 on the opening night in New York, and we come on like it was 8:30, you know, and everybody remarked about it after we got through, but nobody wanted to follow our act. We followed everything they had for the Ziegfeld Follies, and after us came the finale, and followed, Harry Richmond was the one doing that. We opened up in Pittsburgh, and we opened in Pittsburgh. We were such a hit that nothing could go on. Then they waited for us to come back on the stage, But the stage manager said, you're going to put the lights out there or it's going overtime. And that's what upset me. We'll put the lights out on me on my opening night here in the college. Ain't that something? So what I did was come off the stage and go on down to the dressing room. So while they were applauding, I'm still down in the dressing room. I knew I shouldn't have left the stage, but I was so mad I could have killed the stage manager. But I went on downstairs to see that Buck was saying, come on, Buck, come on, come on. Audience come, Buck and Buck, Buck and Buck. So I finally went upstairs, and the guy was there, went on the stage. When Harry Richmond says, you know, there's a little speakeasy down the street, and that's where Buck and Bubbles went. And somebody in the back there hollered, go get them. And we come on the stage, took a bow, and come off. And then the stage manager said, you know, you ain't supposed to leave the stage until after you get through. And you wasn't through yet. I thought I was through. You said it was over time. And that was the end of that. Had no more trouble.
Two things. You know, you were black artists in an era. You I heard you answer this on television. So, black artists in an era when black artists were not allowed to
that's right.
Go a lot of places.
That's right.
But you performed in many different kinds of places.
Yes, I did. And some of the places I performed, I had to put on cork. My partner and I put on cork to fool the public that we weren't colored, that we blacked up like Al Jolson doing Mammy. I was doing the Mammy too, but I was doing Mammy on mine, he was doing Mammy. See the difference between the two songs? I was singing a song for my mother down south, and he was singing this plain old Mammy song, you know, which was terrific. I used to take a talk to the audience and say, my song was to my mother. I'd say, I read your letter, Mammy on mine. I feel much better, Mammy on mine. Still, I'm kind of homesick too. No one can cure me but you, Mammy of mine, below that old Dixon line. Oh, I'm longing to kiss you. I miss you all of the time. I kiss your picture each night, and I read all the letters you write, for they remind me of days of long ago. Oh, Lordy, how I'd like to be with you when I'm alone. And I step back. My thoughts go wandering home. Then I start thinking of you, Mammy, and tell you, I'm feeling so blue, I want to cry. Now I know why Daddy used to say, the good Lord, he blessed us. But when he gave us you, Mammy, you're the bestest little angel divine. You're wonderful, mammy. Of my wine. That knocked Billy down. Then I sang Ailey Ailey, you know, behind that. Those were the days. And the manager of the theater didn't want no Negroes in the theater, especially on the stage. He told my manager, he said, take them out. We don't want them. They're going on the mic. I take them out. My manager got mad. He said, you go back out in front of managing the theater. Said, I'll do this. Take care of my act. So he brought us on the stage doing his act. And I thought about that manager not wanting us in the theater. And that song, Mammy of Mine, hit like a glove to my heart feeling, you know. So when he said, tell the audience about the letter you got from your mother. Then I sing a song, you know. Then after the show was over, biggest hit in 7 years, the manager come back and says, where's those two colored boys? I said, and they locked us in the dressing room, so we wouldn't leave. So we stayed in the dressing room, and I never forget the longest day I lived. Those are the days.